Okay, welcome back. Let's just continue our discussion of these fallacies. So first we'll look at appeal to ignorance. This one can be a little bit subtle, but an argument involves an appeal to ignorance when it tries to form a conclusion on the basis of a lack of proof against the alternatives. So for instance, suppose we're trying to debate about who stole the cookies that were lying on the counter. And someone says, Alice stole the cookies. You've got no proof that anyone else did it. Now, this is a fallacy because the lack of evidence against your conclusion doesn't necessarily make it true. Maybe there's no proof or evidence at all about who stole the cookies. Still, you can't leap to the conclusion that it was Alice just because we can't prove that it was Bob or Carol or Dave or whatever. The idea behind this fallacy is sometimes expressed in the phrase, "The absence of evidence is not evidence of absence." In other words, just because you can't find evidence of something doesn't necessarily mean that it's not the case. So in the example we just looked at, the person is assuming that because there's no evidence that anyone else took the cookies, then it wasn't anyone else, so it must be Alice. But this is a very weak form of reasoning, though. You can't reliably infer that something is the case just because we haven't been able to prove the opposite, right? Okay, next we'll consider two related fallacies known as composition and division. Both of these fallacies have to do with ignoring the differences between a whole and its parts. So let's start with division. With division, a person infers that something is true about a thing's parts just because it's true about the thing as a whole. So for instance, Central Park is beautiful. Therefore, every single part of Central Park is beautiful. Now, Central Park is beautiful, but that doesn't mean that every single part of Central Park is also beautiful. There's got to be some parts that are dirty or ugly or whatever it may be, and that might be true even though Central Park as a whole is a beautiful place. So in this case, it's a fallacy because you're taking something that's true about a thing as a whole, and you're assuming that it must be true of all of its parts. But that's just not the case. All right. Now, composition is basically the opposite of division. With division, we infer from the whole to the parts, whereas with composition, we infer from the parts to the whole. We infer that something must be true about a thing as a whole on the basis of the fact that it's true about its parts. So, for instance, the table is composed of atoms, and the atoms are moving really fast. Therefore, the table is moving really fast. Once again, this is a poor form of reasoning. In general, what these examples show is that there's a difference between what's true about a thing and what's true about its parts. Right? It's true that material objects are made of atoms, and these atoms are moving very fast at a subatomic level. But just because it's true that the atoms are moving, we wouldn't say that the table is moving when it's just sitting there. Right? So once again, we see that what's true about the parts isn't always true about the whole, and vice versa. When you make a fallacy by incorrectly inferring something that's true about the parts to a conclusion about the whole, then that's an example of the fallacy of composition. Okay, and finally, let's take a look at non sequitur, or what's also called missing the point. In ordinary discourse, a non sequitur is kind of a statement that comes out of the blue. It kind of seems disconnected from the rest of the conversation. And similarly, in logic, a non sequitur is when a person draws a conclusion that isn't properly connected with the premises. So let's take a look at this. All dogs are furry, and Fido is a dog. Therefore, it's probably going to rain tomorrow. What? Where does the conclusion that it's probably going to rain tomorrow come from? It doesn't appear to be connected at all with the statements that came before it. Right? It just kind of comes out of the blue. So clearly this is a bad form of argument. An argument is supposed to exhibit logical connection between the premises and the conclusion. And this clearly lacks that. So not all examples of non sequitur are this blatant, but it's obviously not a good way to reason. Okay, so in this video and the last, we discussed the following fallacies: hasty generalization, weak analogy, begging the question, equivocation, appeal to majority, appeal to ignorance, division, composition, and non sequitur. Now, there are certainly more kinds of fallacies out there, but we've covered a very representative sample of the kinds of bad reasoning that you're likely to encounter in these videos. And it can be really useful to be able to spot these errors and point them out to people if they're trying to use them to win an argument.